Okay, we are ready to start. After a long break, so we are going to use now to see how these models, but not only these models, how they can be used for voice pathology, or better, as we say, for voice function assessment. So you may remember from the first slides on the previous session what I called voice, because when I was also a PhD student, it was not so clear what is voice, what is speech. Of course, that was English terms, but I don't think even English people know the difference. So voice, you have to remember, it's not the modulation. It is the modulated signal, but just with from the vocal folds. Okay, so voice pathology, then it is how we can assess the quality of voice or the pathology, if there is such, of our vocal folds. And this is very important because we use these vocal folds to produce our speech. And because if we overdone it, if we really there is a problem, then we may develop a certain disease, and many people end up with serious problems that they cannot talk, or even if they develop cancer, for instance, they lose their voice. And this is very important because then quickly you are isolated from the society, and this is very, very bad. All of us, we take as granted the voice because just we produce it. But it's not really... it's something we have to pay attention to. So all these models that I show you contribute to the analysis of speech. They produce very good systems and have robust estimation. So we will see how then this can be used to develop mathematical models for voice pathology. And there are also hands-on later on this part as well. Okay, so I will introduce you to the topic. If you are not familiar with voice function assessment, I guess you will get a good idea what are the tools we currently use to assess quality of voice. Then there are two important parameters. One is jitter and the other is shimmer. And we will see how we can develop mathematical models of these two phenomena and how this mathematical modeling, one of them is the quasi-harmonic model and the AM-FM modeling, how this modeling can be used for voice function assessment and estimation of jitter and shimmer. Then there is a fourth one, which is the tremor estimation, how to estimate tremor. Tremor is, I will explain also later on what is it, but it is an important estimation parameter, which is very difficult actually to estimate from the voice. Downstairs, if we are successful to install Wave Surfer, you can record your voice. No, actually we can record the voice. You can record your voice and check also the quality of your voice in terms of tremor and jitter. And then we will see how modulation spectra can be used for voice function assessment. Okay, so we can use invasive and non-invasive approaches. We use voice production models, algorithms like the ones that I just mentioned, and also special devices to assess quality of voice. For the goal depends from which point of view you see it and what is your, if you are a medical doctor, for instance, you are looking for objective ways to assess the quality of the voice. For instance, you want to know if you make a treatment, what is the situation before the treatment and after the treatment? Or if you suggest a treatment, what is the evolution, how well the treatment is applied to a specific person. So you want to have an objective way to do that. And at the same time, if you use subjective, that means humans, to assess the voice, because they have big variance between them in their opinion, you would like really to have something which is scientifically proven to be good. So if there is any problem and you go to face some court process, then you can say, okay, look, I have done my best. This is the treatment that I have applied, and accordingly to an objective measure, these are the results that I got, and they are good. So then you will be safe. From an engineering point of view, you want to know really what is going on with that voice production process, because more you know, better the models will be to, for instance, model speech or control speech, which is very important for applications like speech synthesis, we want to control the voice. So it depends from where you come from. Now, there is a big list of devices. The three first are invasive techniques, and we will see some examples from them. Then there are non-invasive techniques, like the electroglottograph. So these are non-invasive, and cameras here, they refer to, if just by watching a video, I mean, if we have a camera, really, we can assess the quality of the voice from the way that you move your articulators. So that will be like an additional information. But the target is either contact microphones or microphones. That means just from the speech signal to do inverse filtering or inverse engineering to try to estimate the signal not at the output of the lips here, but after the vocal folds. And this is called inverse filtering, of course. And it is part of what we call in signal processing blind deconvolution. Now, invasive techniques. So using camera, there is an endoscope that gets here. Then there is light, and we try to see the vocal folds while they vibrate. Because there is an endoscope inside your mouth, you cannot say anything other than ah, because it is open, the mouth. It's very tough. I mean, for me, it was not successful. A medical doctor, this is, first of all, a medical action. It's not an engineer who can do it. For me, it was not successful. I had a very good medical doctor try to apply it on me, but it was really not good. So in order to see now the high speed, the vocal folds vibration, the vocal folds vibrate with, let's say, 100 times per second. There is the vibration. So we cannot see it. How we can assess then the quality with endoscope? The key is the light. And this is like disco. If you go to disco and then you see this light sampling and then you see the other person, not a continuous movement. So if you do the same thing, but you synchronize the vocal fold vibration, that means the F0, with the light, then you see frozen the vocal folds. Of course, we know that voice is not completely, even voice speech is not completely voiced or harmonic, I would say. Then you have estimations of mistakes on the F0 estimation, and all of these may make it more difficult for you to see the vocal folds. Nevertheless, this is what we use in videoscope, in endoscope. Now, I'm not sure if we can see this video. So these are vocal folds, movements, like the ones that you have seen before. And it is just 25 frames per second. And we've measured, let's say, for a few seconds. So here there is aliasing result. Again, there's no sound, sorry, but it is there's breath, it's three times. So breath, etc. You can. Okay. Now, the interesting part is if we do with a high-speed camera, which records 4,000 frames per second, but these 4,000 frames per second, we will see them with 25 frames per second, so it will be like slow motion. And it's just 2 seconds. And this is the real movements of the vocal folds, however. Now, so you have to pay attention here. It's moving, but it's, imagine, it's for 2 seconds. So you have, let's say, 4,000 frames per second, and now you see 25 frames per second. So imagine how many frames you have to see in order to find that. Now it's moving. This is the real movement of the vocal folds. Hope you can see the video. So it's an amazing movement of the vocal folds. So these are the real movement. I don't believe they close completely. Why they should close completely? Sometimes yes, but so this, that's why what we say glottal close resistance for me is very, very misleading. Yeah, you can see it if we play it again. We just have to wait. That, of course, they close, but there are areas which don't close enough, I mean, completely. And the more there is a pathology, then more you see that they cannot close. And that generates some noise. So we will see. Now, what is the problem? The problem here is that this is the real movement of the vocal folds, but who can wait to see 2 seconds of recordings? No one, especially medical doctors, can wait so long to see the movement of the vocal folds. So then the question is there any way to present this but without waiting? So, and this is going to be the next slide. How people try to represent this movement without waiting so long. Okay, then the first trial is you do edge detection, and you put then, you see where the glottis is exactly, and you put some colors, like these colors here. And if you follow, for instance, the movement of the, in the middle, here, the yellow and the green, then you can monitor the moving of these dots. You can monitor this, and this is over time how it moves. Okay? So this is one way to show it. Another way is you do, let me make a zoom here. These are the vocal folds. You make edge detection, right and left. Then this is what you get. And you consider values here from the middle. So these are the values. Then the next step is you take this, you open it, you go like that, and then you create this. So this one, now you see it over time, and you allocate, you do a color map, depending on the amplitude of the right and the left part. Okay, now let's see how such a representation helps. This is then what you get from the movement of the vocal folds, showing again the right and the left part. And then there are, you can make a zoom, and you can try to find some metrics in order to find out if there is any problem in the vocal folds. But such a representation is quick. So very quickly, you can, from these vocal fold movements, you can end up with just a picture. So that is nice. Let's see how that can help on some pathologies. Like, for instance, this one. There is, on the left side, there is a polyp, which means that the vocal folds do not close there. So you see black line. You see it? This one, the second one, is paralysis. So that means the right part does not vibrate. Only the left part vibrates. This creates such a noisy speech, very annoying. And you see here, it's not really red, it's just thin line of red. This is nodules, both sides. So such a representation, which is called phonovibrography, it is one way to visualize high-speed data quickly. Then there is another one, because these high-speed cameras are very expensive. Not many labs have these, and not many doctors use them, because first, it is expensive. Second, still we don't know what is the best representation, and the one that I show you is one candidate for to use with a high-speed camera. But in our lab, here we have a lab in the medical department, medical school, and there we have a high-speed camera, and we work with medical doctors to get data. Now, in video chemography, in order to have a camera not so expensive, you just record, you can adjust which line of pixels you want to follow, and then you see that over time. Then you again see, but specifically for that point, the opening and the closing, the opening and the closing. So yes, here you can see really that there is an opening phase and close phase, but at that specific specific place of the vocal folds. And here is a creaky vocal fry. So you see major opening, then small opening. So here there is all glottal closure, and not so, there is a distance here, so that creates a secondary excitation, but not so big as this one. Okay? So this, yeah. That's true, but you have to pay about 40,000 euros more to buy the other camera. So this is falsetto voice. This is high pitch. There is no any closing here, really. So how to find here a glottal closure instant? That is the problem. So when you go and you ask glottal closure instant for female or children voice, it's very difficult. Here, for instance, you see if there is a problem here. So if with the endoscope, you see that there is somewhere a problem, then in order to make a better idea, you use this video chemography, and then you adjust where is the pixel that you want to monitor, and then you use your video chemography, and then you get this picture with the problem that is here, shown here, it is here as well. There's no closing, good closing, and this is because of the problem. Okay. Now we pass to the non-invasive approaches, the most used one is what we call electroglottography, EGG. And that tries to measure the activity of the vocal folds because while the vocal folds move, bypassing a weak electric current, we can see the impedance of the vocal folds, and this is what we measure, and this is the electroglottography. So it is a representation of the activity of the glottis. Then we go to, because we make a focus now on speech, which is non-invasive as well, and we will see it from a perspective of modeling and analysis. So now you know this model. This is the AM-FM model. And you have seen this, the original, you have seen the reconstructed, and this is the error between the two. How this signal now, it is what we call sustained phonation. That means Okay, so now you see here time and frequency, because as I told you, this model offers the capability to measure a high resolution AM-FM model. So then you can, like the time frequency, to have a time frequency distribution. And here you see the signal, and here you see the time frequency representation of a normophonic voice using the AM-FM model. So it's very parallel, eh? The lines are very parallel, so that means there is a structure. Structure means good control of your vocal folds. Now, this is in terms of dysphonic voice. The first thing that we see that there is area of strong modulations. Now, stronger are these modulations, higher is the probability that your ear will perceive this as noise. And this noise is what is the first indication of a natural voice, of pathology in your vocal folds. For instance, if I say, ah, that's a good ah. If I say, I cannot control my vocal folds because probably there is a pathology, a polypod or something. And this creates noise and modulations. So we will see that. Another technique that we have not seen, because we talk about modulations, that means if we do modulation spectra, there is a chance to detect also voice pathology because we can detect the modulation that exists in speech. So another tool that we have developed, it's called modulation spectra. Modulation spectra is you do like a Fourier transform or whatever transform you want. So you take time and frequency. Well, no. Time and frequency, and then you take this line, which is, you consider that as a time domain signal, and you do a second Fourier, whatever, transform. And then that creates a frequency-frequency representation. One is the modulation frequency, and the other is the usual acoustic frequency. Now, let's see. This is an introduction to the topic. This is the modulation spectra for a female voice. You see that it is around 200 hertz. Now, this is acoustic. This is modulation frequency of a normophonic speaker. If you go to the dysphonic speaker and you see the same picture, it's like that. So a lot of modulations. Now, okay, so that was the last slide on introduction. Now we go and we see the estimation of jitter. Jitter is, and shimmer, we can say, are perturbations in irregularities from period to period. And jitter is about perturbations in terms of periodicity. So that we do not have an exact periodic signal. Of course, we know that the only periodic signal can be created by machines. Humans who create a natural signal, not periodic. You can consider it as periodic, but in reality it is not. Now, of course, you can measure. So my voice, even if I say this is nearly periodic. But my F0 is not constant. So this, the perturbations of the periodicity from period to period, this is called jitter. So I have jitter. You have jitter. But our jitter, hopefully, is not pathologic because it has low value. And you will see what I mean by value. Now, if your jitter is becoming the bigger in terms of value, then there is a chance that there is a problem in your vocal folds. So, since it is period-to-period variability of pitch, one estimator is this local jitter, where this is the pitch contour. I cannot write on the PDF very nicely, but anyways. So it is a pitch contour, okay? So then you see N is the time. So you see after and before, you do make a derivative. Or absolute jitter is this one. Now, what is the problem of this measurement, which has been used probably the last 50 years? It is exactly the estimator of this one. In order to estimate the F0, you make the assumption that your signal is stationary. So it has the same F0 value. For how many frames depends on what is the method. But if you use the autocorrelation method, for instance, in order to estimate the F0, you make that assumption of stationarity for a long window. Then, after doing that assumption, you estimate a value which I don't know what is it. It is a measurement of periodicity. Yeah, okay. But making the assumption that everything is periodic, well, it is not. And then on top of that, you take the derivative in order to measure the period-to-period variability. So that is the mistake, I believe. While the jitter as an idea is good, the way to estimate it is very tricky because that U of N makes strong assumptions about speech. Then, what is the method that we can have? So the assumption, here we suggest what we call the spectral jitter model, SJE. In that case, we try to model the jitter with a mathematical term, which means we put impulses here. P is the pitch period, and here is 2 times the period. So we have impulses every 2p, and then another term, which is, this is the even periods, these are the odd periods. So if I add this together, and assuming that this epsilon is equals to 0, then I have a fully periodic signal with distance from one click to the other, from one impulse to the other, equals to P capital. But if now I change epsilon, and epsilon is not 0, then these 2 signals, they are not anymore periodic. And then I create jitter. Of course, this jitter is cyclic jitter. That means I see it every 2 periods, I see that. But nevertheless, it is... So if you make that assumption that in a short window you can just see 2 to 3 periods, then you may have a chance to get the jitter without estimating the pitch or without relying a lot on pitch. And let's see how. In order to do that, we write the frequency domain, the magnitude spectrum of this jittered impulse train. So here there is a very important term, which is this one, which again we have to follow and track that epsilon. So we take this, that important part, this, and then we can easily show that this one is equal to this part. When we multiply cosines, then we generate what we call bit spectrum. Because we say bit spectrum, spectrum, because we are in the frequency domain here. And that bit spectrum, the bit spectrum is like that. You may remember that from physics, bit signal. So the crossings depend where we have the crossings over frequency, depends again on epsilon, which is our jitter. So let's see where we can use that. We develop further the, our mathematical model, and then we see that we have one part which is at harmonics, which we call harmonic spectrum, and another part which is at half of the harmonics, which means subharmonics. So we have now two spectra. So whenever, that means whenever we have jitter, we have two spectra to deal with. Not only the magnitude spectrum of speech at the harmonics, but the magnitude spectrum of speech at the subharmonics. And these two interact. More interaction, more conflict between them. More conflict means more noise that we perceive. And this is jitter. So the jitter now, so this mathematical model proves why jitter produces noise. And let's see how it is. Now, if I put that epsilon equals to zero, that means there is no jitter. If there is no jitter, there is no interaction. We can show that because there is no then Cobb spectrum, so there is no interaction between the harmonic spectrum and the subharmonic spectrum. And unfortunately, here I have all of them, but this is, and this is with epsilon equals to zero for the harmonic spectrum and the subharmonic spectrum. Mainly, the subharmonic spectrum does not exist because, simply because everything is harmonic. So all the energy is here. Now we put jitter. Epsilon is equal to one. Then this is what we get. This is the harmonic spectrum. This is the subharmonic spectrum. How many interactions? One. Because epsilon is equal to one. Then if we increase jitter, then this is the spectrum of the harmonics. This is the spectrum of the subharmonics. How many? One, two. And epsilon here is two for the case of the squares. In short, with that epsilon, I can control how many crossings there will be between the harmonic spectrum and the subharmonic spectrum. And more I have crossings, more noise I perceive in these areas. Okay? Now, using that measurement, what is called spectral jitter estimator, we tested on two databases. One is very typical one, and it is suggested by Massachusetts something there in US, May, which is not, however, that's a very standard database for voice pathology, but it's not a good one. Simply because the recordings between normophonic and dysphonic speakers have been recorded with different microphones. Then, obviously, even with silence, you can separate to some extent the normophonic speakers from the dysphonic speakers. So everybody gets good results on that database. So this is what we call a multidimensional voice profile, which is a commercial program sold by K Elementrics, now K Pendex. And this is using, since we do detection, we do receiving operating characteristic curves, ROC curves, and then we measure the area under the curve. Bigger is the area under the curve, better is our detector. So here it is MDVP measures jitter the way that I described initially, gives this score, which is a very good score. Pratt, which is freely available, it is also very good, but SJE, it is 94. Now, okay, there is an improvement. If we go to another database, which is a Spanish database provided from us from University of Madrid, you see that there is MDVP cannot cope. Really, the score is low. While, of course, for all the techniques it's slow, it's low, but for SJE, it's much higher than the others. So it has provided better score, which means that this mathematical modeling of jitter makes sense. However, medical doctors, they don't care about this. This is really something, a first test to see if you can separate normal phonic voice from the dysphonic voices. But no one will pay attention to these results. I mean, for engineers, they will pay attention, but medical doctors, no one. They are not interested in this. To what they are interested, you will see later on. So here, we put now a threshold for jitter, because we know from some databases that some people are really dysphonic, some others are normophonic, and by separating, by getting this area under the curve score, we have put the threshold, the best threshold, in order to achieve the better area under the curve score. So then we see for, let me make again zoom, this is for a normal signal. This is the value of the jitter in microsecond. So if it is, this is a 124 about microseconds, this is the threshold for jitter. If you have below that value, then it's fine. But occasionally, of course, you can go up over that threshold. And you can see, really, this is a normal reading text. This is seconds. While you speak, we can measure using spectral jitter, and by measuring the harmonic spectrum and the subharmonic spectrum, the spectral jitter. And we see that there are values that, indeed, they go higher. Then we can measure how many frames contiguous they are above a threshold or below. So if we say we will stick with the over, what is the percentage of the samples which are above, over the threshold, then for a normophonic speaker, this is 13%. But for a dysphonic speaker, this is 80%. So then, based on that, we suggest to have a metric on what we call over. Then this over, or max over, or max under, this is max under, this is max over, and while the other percentage is just over, all of them over. So this is the area under the curve for this database, but not on sustained vowels. There is, in that database, there are two types of recordings. One is sustained vowels, that means ah. The other is what they call the rainbow passage. So people are speaking. Obviously, you cannot have an endoscope there while you are reading that. Medical doctors believe that a lot of interesting phenomena happens while you are talking, not just a sustained vowel. That's why they don't like the endoscope, and they want to see also methods to assess the voice function assessment, but on running speech. So this is one way, the speaker jitter, it is one way to do that. So we tested on rainbow passage, and indeed, the area under the curve is good, but for May. Then we can develop two metrics. One is called local, so to see, you put a window, and you follow in that inside that window how many times, what is the value of the OVA. And you just shift the window, and we call that local over. The other thing is that if you have problem and you start talking, you may start with good quality, but because you get your vocal folds, you don't control very well your vocal folds, then after two seconds, you lose the control, and then more and more noise is building up, and you end up with a very bad quality. So then this is what we call running. So that means it's like accumulating statistics. So at the end, you arrive to a statistic by getting more and more data that something is pathologic, not only based on the local. This does not work. I will play some sounds. Okay, so this is example from May, running over. This is from a normal signal. So more and more here we accumulate statistics with seconds here. This is the time, and then after 12 seconds of voicing, we are pretty sure that there is no problem. If there is, we have here separated the area of over into three categories. Normal, so that means you have normal jitter, which is mean green. There is then the indeterminate, let's say. So it's not you cannot really say anything. It's the gray area. And then there is the pathologic area, which is red. So while you are talking, then, okay, occasionally we took a decision, but after really accumulating statistics, we found that, no, it's fine. Your voice is fine. This is for a pathologic signal, the second one. So you see, while we are talking, we are pretty sure that something goes wrong. This is local over. That means just a window, and you see what is happening inside that window. So even for normophonic speakers, yeah, while you talk, you may have jitter. But for the pathologic signal, for the dysphonic speakers, very often you go over that threshold. Now, obviously, if you change your threshold, you change also the data. So it is threshold dependent. This is good to know because you will play with the threshold downstairs in the hands-on session. Unfortunately, this is now before treatment, because you remember the medical doctor wants to see what happened after the treatment. Can we have an objective measure? They don't care if you can distinguish dysphonic from normal phonic voices. Okay, to do what with that? But if you can really find a metric to show the difference between before and after treatment, this is very, very important for them. It has really big, nice value. I will turn this on just in case playing by from the speakers you listen. So this is before treatment. Let's see. Ah, it's me. Yes. Okay. So that is before treatment. This is after treatment. This is the same speaker. Before treatment and after treatment. And Yeah. So you will test also your voice downstairs.
What was the treatment?
Drink Reiki, yes, for 5 days. Smoke a lot. Yeah. Yes, obviously, because if you have something and your vocal folds have big inertia, exactly. So that is why when you smoke, there are a lot of particles that are accumulated here, and your vocal folds become really heavy, like mine. But if we take them out, your voice will become again female voice and with nice characteristics. Yeah, that's the pitch. Yeah, but that is because of the interaction, according to the spectral jitter model, it is the interaction of the harmonic and the subharmonic spectra. That interaction creates zones in low frequencies of noisy. And in speech synthesis, sometimes, you know, we say, tend to say that this is band aperiodicity, this is a periodic part, this is non-periodic part, but all this comes because of the jitter, major part, because jitter exists in normal voices. Of course, if you have a lot of jittering, then you have a lot of noise, and then you perceive it with a lot of noise. Here, the jitter is low. That means there are very few interactions between the harmonic spectrum and the subharmonic spectrum, which means you do not perceive this interaction, and that means less noisy. Is that okay? Good. You will play with exactly this signal downstairs. Now, if you want to read more about this spectral jitter estimation, there are two journal papers with Miltos Vasilakis on how to do this spectral jitter modeling and how then to suggest this green and red area on short-time jitter estimation in running speech. And what is the nice application of that? Now I'm talking. I could have really an indicator there with red and green while I'm talking, and I have a closed talk microphone here. What is the quality of my voice by measuring the jitter? Then I can see if it is always green. That means it is fine. Of course, I can adjust it because the threshold changes a lot the values. But assuming that I have a threshold, then if I see that there is red and it stays red for 10 minutes, that means I misuse my vocal folds. So it's better to stop talking. That's a good application. So now we move from the jitter estimation to, again, jitter and shimmer, but using another mathematical model. And this is based on the adaptive of the quasi-harmonic model of speech. So here we show shimmer. This is shimmer. So what is shimmer? Is perturbation from period to period, but in terms of amplitude. So everything is periodic, but the amplitude, there is an oscillation. Then this is jitter. That means from period to period, the F0 really changes. And that is modeled, the jitter here is by this delta. While the shimmer is modeled by this gamma. Yes?
With a language
You mean for running speech, the spectral jitter estimator you mean now?
Yeah.
Oh, so the previous topic. Okay. You need indeed the pitch value, but not you do not rely on it. Just to have a first estimation of your harmonic spectrum and the subharmonic spectrum. But you do not make measurements really on the on using these harmonics. So a simple estimator of F0 will work for voices. Now, of course, if you are seeing the unvoiced parts, there is no activity trying to be periodic. So then the notion of jitter in that term does not apply. But you have other areas, definitely in the check also. You have also voicing. Yeah? So then we try to see during the voicing parts. Hmm? But that voicing can be anything. It's not necessary to be a sustained vowel. Hmm? Now, this is another mathematical model for jitter and shimmer. So this is the principle of the jitter and shimmer. And then we will see how such a modeling can be used inside the sinusoidal models. So again, this is a sinusoidal model in terms of AM, FM. So this is the excitation, and this is the vocal tract. This is the excitation phase, and this is the vocal tract phase. The phases are added, the magnitude information is multiplied. And this is the excitation phase, which is the integral of the instantaneous frequency plus a phase offset. So this is the model that we have seen also in the previous slides. Okay, then here is how the jitter and the shimmer comes into the equations. So we already introduced a model for jitter and a model for shimmer. And these are the values. You can make also delta as a function of the frequency, so to have a jitter now in each frequency band. But we choose here not to do it. So we can also have the same thing for shimmer. For a reason here, we kept it. So now, let's go back. So you have to remember this one. This is the excitation amplitude. And of course, this one. So now we will change this excitation amplitude and frequency based on this. So we put a formula for these two components. Then we introduce them to the AMFM model, and this is what we get, or after some multiplications, etc., we end up with this model. So which means a sinusoidal model which accounts also for jitter and shimmer has this formula, this way. Where now we see as a function of frequency, the jitter and the shimmer. So these are the unknowns now. The unknowns for jitter and shimmer. This is the jitter. So the question is how we can solve the equation of the mean squared error in order to estimate gamma k and delta k. So in order to do that, we suggest a kind of AQ, quasi-harmonic model, and now the time is not just t here, but it's sinus of 2 pi f0 t, and here is cosine, and this bk and ck, they are complex values, and we decompose them, bk and ck, as we did for QHM, over ak. This is the decomposition of bk and ck over ak. And then we end up with this model. So by doing this, this one is becoming like this one. So now this is our model, and let's see how it is compared with the initial model. So what we want was this one, and what we suggest is this one. So now you will start seeing the relationship between the shimmer and jitter sinusoidal model and the model that we get by considering the version of the quasi-harmonic model. So easily you can see, for instance, that this gamma k cosine k is actually this pi here, or that the delta k sinus ck is this rho 2. So through this, that means if you now estimate ak, a, b, c, and based on this comparison, you can estimate the jitter and the shimmer. And these are the equations. Just by associating the two models, this is the association, and then very easily, you end up with this solution for the shimmer and for the jitter. Okay, that is the theory. How you are going to validate that? We can generate synthetic signals where we know the jitter and the shimmer. Then we try to identify if really the model can cope with the jittering and the shimmer, the jitter and the shimmer effect. So again, you may remember this is the model of the jitter, that we had the spectral jitter model. And then, however, the amplitudes A1 and A2, they are given by these equations. So what are these equations? For what they count for? For jitter or shimmer? What is that? A perturbation over amplitude. So is it for jitter or shimmer? Shimmer. So this is the shimmer. And this is the jitter. So this is in order to create the synthetic signals. Then we pass this, we call that the glottal airflow rate. The glottal airflow rate. And we pass it, because these are the impulses mainly. Then we convolve this with the glottal airflow. And then after that, we pass the complete excitation signal through a vocal tract, that means an AR filter. Okay? So that makes, we can then measure, we can make A from, we can use A from a real speech, male speaker, to estimate this AR. And then we pass the combined excitation through this AR and we create the synthetic signal. So now, using this epsilon and alpha, A, we can control jitter and shimmer. So here, I will make zoom. This is the signal, the solid line with shimmer, and the dashed line is the model with the sinusoidal model, the simple sinusoidal model. So you can see that, for instance, here or here, we cannot estimate the amplitude because simply the sinusoidal model is stationary. So all the amplitudes are the same. Of course, here we see a windowing signal, but nevertheless, we cannot really estimate at the center of our analysis window, we cannot make a good estimation of amplitude because of the reason that I just mentioned. And you must know that mean squared estimation means that at the center, because you put a lot of weight there, the estimation should be very, very good. When, once you go away from your center of your window, then more is the error of the modeling. So here, at the center of your analysis window, where you expect really the estimator to be very good, it's not good because of the shimmer. Then, this is with a suggested sinusoidal model. So you see that now the difference between the two ones. So with this one, the shimmer is, we take into account that probably there is shimmer. We take that into account in order to estimate the amplitudes. And this is the error from A and B. From A, you see that there is this error at the center, as we mentioned. We do not capture very well the amplitude. While for the second one, the suggested sinusoidal model, the error is mainly zero, as you see it. It is this dashed line here, mainly zero. Okay. Then we go to jitter, same thing. This is the standard sinusoidal model, the dashed line. So the amplitude is not modified now. The shimmer, there is no shimmer, there is only jitter. So you see that the standard sinusoidal model cannot synchronize its impulses with the original signal because of this jitter effect. Now, if you go and you see it on the suggested sinusoidal model, even if of this jittering, still the sinusoidal model, the suggested sinusoidal model, even if you give F0 to that model, still can measure this perturbation over over a period, and these perturbations are modeled in the signal. But if these are modeled, then you can use them to estimate the jitter and the shimmer. And again, this is the error. Again, the same thing. And then we tested again on May to see if both jitter and shimmer can tell us anything about voice pathology. And we find a good, this is a raw curve, and this is the area under the curve, 92%, let's say, which is not bad. Now, if you want to learn more about this, there are two, of course, there is this exchange transaction paper on AMFM decomposition, and another one we made on in a conference about how to model jitter and shimmer. Yeah. Yeah, well, in natural speech, you have both. You have jitter and shimmer, because nothing is, you know, so nicely periodic, even in over time or over amplitude. So a normal voice has both jitter and shimmer. So you apply the model as it is and gives you a measurement of both jitter and shimmer. Now, how do you combine this in order to take a decision? That's, of course, it's another discussion. We did not pay attention to that in order to maximize, for instance, to put a weight and maximize the area under the curve. And nevertheless, we tested only on May. But the main message is, yes, with this model, you can measure both at the same time. And everything starts with a mathematical modeling of speech. Yeah. Exactly. Yes. Yes. I believe so. Yeah, it's better, actually. It will be more accurate. But indeed, we have not tested on, for instance, speech synthesis or something else. Yes. Yeah, 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 indeed. Yes. Yes. Okay, so other questions? You care, I see that you make a lot of questions about voice pathology. So you always ask me questions. Do you have a, why? May I ask why? It's interesting.
It's very human.
Medical applications. So it's always interesting to see medical applications. Yeah, that's a very interesting, I think, direction of speech signal processing, of speech processing. Because that's the one signal that we produce. And there are a lot of things that are from the vocal folds, for the hearing aids that Rainer Martin will talk to us tomorrow, and then how we process this here, and how this then controls the modulators again, and if there is any motor, let's say, problem, as we say, the way that we control the vocal folds, probably speech is in an early indication of if there's any problem in our brain. So this makes really a nice topic of research for speech. And there are not, so for voice pathology, there were papers. There are people who work on that, but I don't see many too many papers at interspeech. So the community is only oriented to solve towards this human-machine communication issue. But I think there are very interesting applications on the speech itself, because it is one signal that we, humans, we produce. If there are no... Yeah, please. So you mean if you start to have some problems, then you start... The jitter and shimmer, they try to detect a bit, because all this creates mainly noise and modulations, and the perception of this noise and modulations...
Maybe slur is more...
Yeah, yes, actually it is articulators, but I have not tested, I'm not sure. I mean, we can discuss it, of course, but...
No, but it's an interesting idea.
Yes. Yes, yes. It is. Yeah. Yes, yeah, you spot that. That's another application, indeed. Actually, there are applications in order to protect also the professionals. For instance, a teacher is a professional. He is using the voice to teach. It's not only the singer. It's not a pop musicians, etc. Okay. Yeah, please. Yes, I see. Yeah, we have not tested this model on emotional data. No. The May is only constructed for voice pathology, and they have recorded normophonic and dysphonic speakers saying sustained vowels and also the rainbow passage. That's all. And of course, these people, they had all, not high-speed camera, but definitely a camera to see the quality of their vocal folds. And we know for sure that they are normophonic or dysphonic speakers. But they made a mistake to make the recording with different microphones, so which is a pity. But yes, no emotions there. So it would be a good idea to test these models also for emotions. Indeed. That's a good idea, actually. You, that you work on sensorial models for emotions. I think that's a good idea. But, yeah. Other questions? No. Okay, we will make a break. Just drink some water, relax, and then we go to the towards the second part. I hope that I gave you motivation to come to the hands-on session. So we will see more later on. Okay? Thank you. Okay. So we stopped last time when we were working on, we said about the sinusoidal model and how that model can incorporate jitter and shimmer inside. And what is the mechanism using sinusoids to estimate the jitter and shimmer? Now, we go to another application, which is a very important application, how to estimate tremor in voice. Tremor is not only in voice, but there are also mechanical tremor. That means devices that, unfortunately, they produce tremor, and you want to estimate how much tremor they produce. But the same thing also happens with humans. So then the question is, first of all, what is tremor? Because, to be honest, 6 years ago, I had no idea what is tremor. And then tremor has been introduced to me from Dr. Jean Schengen from Brussels University. And since then, we start to work on tremor, how to estimate tremor. So what is tremor? There are modulations that we do not control, modulations of frequency and amplitude. And we try to estimate tremor in sustained phonation, like ah, etc. Like jitter, there is pathological and physiological, that means normal, vocal tremor. So our voice has vocal tremor already. As I said, you know, if strong motor synchronization means no tremor, but if that starts to have problems, then we start observing tremor. Tremor below a value is physiological. Above that value is pathological. So the key idea is what are the modulations really that we have to look at? And this is the modulations that we are looking at are between 2 hertz and 15 hertz. That's the modulation of the voice. Below 2 hertz is mainly there is modulation of our voice, but this is because of our heart. It's cardiac modulation. So we have to remove this, the heartbeat that modulates our voice, and look at the very low modulation frequencies. Since you are looking at the very low modulation frequencies, your analysis window cannot be really very short. And that is one big problem, and you are invited to solve it. So when we use sinusoidal model, like the AM-FM model that I have shown to you, still you need some long window in order to estimate very low modulations. So what are the vocal tremor attributes? When you look for tremor, what does it mean? You look for modulation frequency and for modulation level. So modulation frequency is how fast are the modulations. Modulation level is how strong are the modulations. So we use, again, an AM-FM decomposition algorithm, the QHM, and because that offers to us high resolution in the time frequency plane, and we can estimate the vocal tremor if we want for any sinusoidal component. Of course, probably I don't know if that has any interest in practice, because the tremor is related to the modulation of the vocal folds. So why to estimate then tremor in high frequencies? Well, I don't know. I would be interested probably. But what I will show you and all of the methods that we have done is based on just one component. And then many people, when they say tremor, they give you one value of the tremor. Your tremor is, and you will see, according to the attributes that I will show you, what is your tremor? They give you one value for all the phonation that you have done. But actually, it is interesting to estimate tremor as a function of time. In order to understand very well the tremor, actually, it is the following. When you go and you do a presentation at a conference, and you are fresh PhD, I mean, just you started your PhD, then you are very anxious. I mean, you don't know how it will go. And so you start talking, and then if we measure your tremor there, it's high. It's probably pathologic. But more you get confidence, more you can control your tremor. Okay? So tremor has been used from CAA to check if you say truth or not. So you have stress, for instance. That's a good stress estimator. So, as I said, we know that already, so that's good. Nothing to say on this slide, because we have said so many things so far. And here is the time and frequency plane computed using this AM-FM component. Also, we have seen this figure. So you see now here the tracks of sustained phonation. This is a male voice, 100 hertz, twice the F0, 200 hertz, 300 hertz, etc. So now we isolate just one component. Again, if you think that there is a difference, you are invited to check the same algorithm on the higher harmonics. So we select just one. And because we are looking for modulations 2 to 15 kilo, hertz, we can downsample that signal from 16 kilohertz to just 1,000 hertz. Then we must remove the very slow modulations because, again, that comes from our cardiac, our heartbeat. And the way that we did with Savinsky-Golay filter, which is a smoothing filter, a filter that is not so much used in signal processing. It has been used in chemistry. It's very nice. It's a very nice model. And there is in signal IEEE Signal magazine, there is a nice report on Savinsky-Golay filter and its properties, because someone has said, oh, that's an interesting interesting filter, and no one is using it for signal processing. So, yes. Now, let's see how we apply this Savinsky-Golay. Okay, you see this solid line. The solid line is that F0 measurement, but after removing the mean value. So that was around 100 hertz. So now it is around zero, of course, because we removed the mean value. Then we detect the heartbeat, and we remove it from using the Golay filter, Savinsky-Golay filter. This is the dashed line. So the dashed line actually are the modulation from your heart. Now, if we do the Fourier transform, if we consider that this signal over time is stationary, which is wrong as an assumption, nevertheless, we can make a Fourier transform. So we average all the spectral information, and this is what we get. The solid line corresponds to the solid line, and there is strong modulation from our heart, which is the dashed line. So the S-Golay filter estimates that, and this is really, indeed, the activity below 2 hertz. Then if we subtract the dashed line from the solid line, we have a component which is free of the heartbeat. Then, on that signal, we apply one component, AM-FM analysis, using quasi-harmonic model. And, interesting enough, now this AM-FM model is a non-stationary model of speech. So you don't make any assumption of stationarity because your signal is quite dynamic and changes. So it's not stationary. So the solid line is again the original signal, and the dashed line is your AM-FM signal. So it tracks very well, much better than what Kalman can do, your waveform. Now, how you can say if this is good or bad? Oh, no, it is good or bad because you reconstruct it and you put, you overlay the original signal with the reconstructed signal. And you see that the reconstructed signal follows the original signal. Now, this, you remember, that comes from one component, AM-FM. So, oh, not yet. Now, if I do the Fourier transform, when people tell you this is your tremor, they give you actually, they do Fourier transform of the signal, and they take where the center of gravity is. For instance, probably the center of gravity here is around, I don't know, 6, 5, because you have these big components here, so the center of gravity is around 5. Now, if someone says, no, I will take the maximum, then this is 7. But again, this comes from a stationary analysis of that signal, which is not valid. And the dashed line corresponds to this frequency. So this is not nice. What is nice, however, how we can really make it better? If we see the modulation frequency and the modulation level as a frequency of, as a function of time. So that means that AM-FM component that you have seen that tracks so nicely the original signal, it is produced by amplitude multiplied by the cosine of this one at every sample. So you see now a dynamic information. Now you can say two things here. First of all, what is the modulation frequency? You see that the modulation frequency actually varies as a function of time. So you have, you can have a tremor estimator as a function of time now. That was a very important goal. And the second one, you can say really here, what is the frequency, the tremor frequency, and no, and also the modulation level. So according to that, your voice can be considered as normophonic or dysphonic in terms of tremor. I hope that no one's voice will be detected as having a problem with tremor, because either you have stress when you will do your hands-on, or there is a problem here. I hope that everyone's voice, that if you do the recordings, will come out with nice results, with modulation level very low. Am I right, Maria? Okay, Maria is working on tremor, used to work. Okay, so that is the part of modulation for tremor. Estimation using AM-FM. So that is another application of the AM-FM model. And these are the papers presented by Maria on that tremor. Now we move to the modulation spectra. As we said, voice pathology means modulations. Actually, there is always modulations. While we are speaking, there are always modulations. Modulation level 1, modulation level 2. So the modulations are very important in during speech production. And actually, there was a paper recently from Tomoki Toda who shown that synthetic speech has a problem because also lacks modulations, natural modulations. And he was trying to restoring the modulations of the synthetic signal. Okay, again, the principle is just, you do Fourier transform, you have a time frequency distribution, and then you get this one, so you consider it as a time domain signal, and you do another Fourier transform or another transform, and then you end up with a frequency-frequency representation. So if we use Fourier transform, what I have said equations, it is, this is the standard short-time Fourier transform. These are the basis functions, the regular Fourier transform basis functions, these ones. This is your analysis window, and this is your signal. So this is what we call the short-time Fourier transform. And I1 denotes the number of frequency bins. And this is in the acoustic frequency axis. Then we take the magnitude spectrum as input signal over time now. This is M. Then we apply again Fourier transform. This is again the same thing. And we apply a window. And that gives us the modulation, the frequency-frequency modulations, and I2 is the number of the frequency bins along now the modulation frequency axis. So now we have acoustic frequency axis and modulation frequency axis. And these are from K and I. Now, depending on the size of this analysis window, that determines which modulation frequencies we are looking at. Such a method, however, cannot be used for very low modulation frequencies. Why? Because you need a high resolution in order to be able to see differences in 3-4 hertz, as we saw in tremor. But this is good at the level of pitch, for instance, modulations at that kind of frequencies. So this is a modulation spectra images that we get using normophonic, normal phonation, and abnormal phonation. You have seen that already during the introduction. And also we see that between, for instance, two dysphonic voices, the adductor spasmodic dysphonia on the left and on the right, the vocal nodules, we see that there is a difference in the way that the energy is distributed over frequencies, acoustic and modulation frequencies. So these are now pictures, as you can see. So how we can use these pictures to get any information about pathology in your voice? So what we do, we have instances of your R. Then we make that picture that you just saw, and we put together, we stack together all these images. So that means we put matrices, one after the other, and that creates a tensor. And we want now, because these are too many features, is how to select features in order to make from that tensor how to select features in order to detect if there is a pathologic voice or not, because you have many features. So you end up with the problem of feature selection. So we have tensor, and this is a nice way to make fusion. So these are the acoustic frequencies, the modulation frequencies, and how many frames, how many times you put these, how many instances you have. And then we apply what we call high order SVD. So we decompose the tensor into, as we call, n-mode singular vectors. And then we can, as we do in normal SVD, we can rank the singular values. So in order to keep a certain percentage of energy, as we say, of the tensor D, then that means we put a threshold. And by doing so, that we keep few singular values, and that is the R1 and R1 and R2, and then we truncate then the matrices, the singular which have the singular vectors, to the acoustic frequency and modulation frequency matrices. Then, if new data are coming, we project this new data B into the truncated matrices, and that makes another representation Z, which just has R1 by R2 dimension. So in doing this higher order SVD, you reduced that tensor into a matrix, but in a nice way. And that is the high order SVD. Okay, just an example. For instance, starting a tensor of this dimension, we end up with this matrix. It's a lot of features reduction. So if we want to see how the higher order SVD reduced the redundancy that exists in the features, then here is a distribution of mutual information using original features, the tensor, and this is the redundancy, mainly nothing, it's low redundancy, of the packed, as we say, features, that 31 by 31 vector matrix. So that means we reduced the features, but we reduce also the redundancy mainly. Okay, so that's the first step. Then the second step is how you can use now that result to do feature selection. And the feature selection is done through mutual information. The mutual information that there are many ways to measure it. You have to pay attention because it's not straightforward. It may contain mistakes, the way that you compute the mutual information. But anyway, one criterion that you can apply is what we call the maximal relevance criterion. That means you are trying to maximize, to find the features that are more relevant for your classification problem. Then, using the mutual information, as I said here, we compute the mutual information between the features and the class. Then we rank all the computed mutual informations, and we select the top M features. That's the standard approach to compute, to select features based on information theory criteria, like the maximal relevance criterion. Okay, so here we show two results. One is simply detection between normophonic and dysphonic voices using, I guess, this is using May, again, database. So again, the area under the curve is high. Okay, it's not a surprise, of course, because that is an easy database. But then we went one step further, and we said, can we use modulations in order to distinguish not only if it is pathologic, but what kind of pathology is there? Quite tricky, I would say. And I'm not sure really if the results are valid, but nevertheless, we've shown that we can discriminate well using, look at this, discrimination scores. Well, polyps from adductive adductor spasmodic dysphonia, for instance, or a polyp from keratosis, or from vocal nodules. So it shows that probably, yes, all these, they generate different types of modulations, and using high-order SVD, and this maximal relevance criterion, it seems that you are able to detect some features which are good even to separate the pathology. But, okay, that was one test. I'm not sure really if, I don't know, I like to see more tests in order to say more about that. But nevertheless, this is a motivation to do further tests using modulations. These results, if you show them to the medical doctor, they don't care. I mean, they say, I don't like this result. Because, first of all, what you are trying to do? Are you going to replace me? It's not, and of course, we don't like to replace the medical doctor. But, for instance, why to find if this is polypod or adductospasmodic dysphonia? They don't really like that. Probably for screening, maybe useful, but not to take any decision. Actually, you don't need to think that as an engineer, you make an algorithm for a system to take decision, because that has very, very important consequences if you make a mistake. And there's no authority. I mean, no one will authorize such a device. But to make, to provide measurements, yes, that's good. So then we did some work to fuse modulation spectra, because modulation spectra are not like magnitude spectra. So from magnitude spectra, we can have Mel frequency caps coefficients, as people use, and then to see how we can fuse with normal with modulation spectra. So that is the fusion. The other thing is having different databases, one from Spain, the other from Greece, the other from United States, different recordings, different microphones, how you are going to use the same algorithm on all of these. For instance, if you claim that you have an algorithm that works well and someone from Japan sends you one signal, how are you going to say that this is pathologic or this is dysphonic if you don't know even what are the recording conditions? So in order to do that, we suggested, but not shown here, what we call normalized modulation spectra in order to count also for these cases. And then it comes a very nice application that medical doctors really like a lot. And that was something that medical doctors pay attention to. How to use modulation spectra to assess in an objective way voice quality in some grades, like measurements like grade, roughness, asthenia, strain, and breathness scale. In short, GRASP. Actually, this comes from Japan. And many people are using now this scale. They try to assess the voice along these five dimensions. In order to do that, you have people who are experts in listening to voice. They are voice pathologists. There is another phoniatrics, you know, and then they are listening and they grade. The problem with them is that between different humans, they do the correlation of evaluation is like less than 60%. Now, if the same person takes the test now and 2 days later, the correlation is about 75%. So it's not so easy to assess quality of voice using this scale. And using modulation spectra, just graden or hoarseness, what do we say graden? Sometimes it is hoarseness, which is means noisy, and breathiness, we arrive to nearly 79% correlation, which means better than what the humans are doing. And that is an interesting result for voice pathology. This is nice for the medical doctors. Okay, I already mentioned fusion. So this black line is MFCC, Mel frequency caps and coefficients. This is with maximal relevance modulation spectra, the blue line. And when we do the fusion, which shows that there is this provide complementary information, this is what we get. That is on May. PDA, it's not as good as the results, of course. This is a more difficult database, but nevertheless, it shows that the fusion is good. Now, key references for the work on modulation spectra. There is a transaction paper on modulation spectra for voice pathology with Maria Markaiki, an ex-PhD student of mine. And then some collaboration work with some people in Spain who actually made the recordings for PDA, that database in Spanish, and some other conference. During this presentation, I refer to some works. If you are interested in phonovibrography, it's very difficult for me to pronounce it, this is a key paper to understand this high-speed camera and how to visualize the high-speed camera quickly. If you just you keep one line, this is the video chemography, and that is an invention from Jan Svek, a very talented person in the Czech Republic. Then Natalie Andries, Christoph D'Alessandro. There is someone who comes from Christoph D'Alessandro lab? No. From LIMC? There is a person from LIMC, yeah. They use the electroglottographic devices to assess the pathologic voices. Atlas and Shama, they suggested the modulation spectrum. And yes, some work from us. So, this part, I like to acknowledge Miltos Vasilakis for the spectral jitter estimator, Maria Markaki for modulation spectra, and Yannis Pandazis for the AMFM model. And that was a collaboration with Olivier Rozek and my current PhD student, Maria Kutsogiannaki, who worked on tremor estimation. Currently, of course, she continues to work on voice pathology, and she has a paper at Interspeech. Correct. And but you work in another aspect of voice, which is the intelligibility of the casual speech, how to improve the intelligibility of casual speech, which is a bit different from the pathologic voice, but has some relationships to some extent. Okay, so really I like to thank all these people that they worked with me all these years to produce these results and then be able to show it to you. And thank you again for your attention also in this part. So thank you very much.